So very good morning to one and all present here. Your work is going to fill a large part of your life. And the only way to be truly satisfied is to do what you believe is great work. And the only way to do great things is to love what you do. If you haven't found it yet, keep looking. Don't settle. As with all matters of the heart, you will know when you find it. With this note, I would like to welcome our today's resource person, Dr. B. Sivaselvan sir, who is currently working as an associate professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Indian Institute of Information Technology, Design and Manufacturing, Kanchipuram. Sir has completed his bachelor's degree in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering from Bharathiyar University, Coimbatore. And sir has completed his master's in Computer Science and Engineering from Indian Institute of Technology, Chennai. Sir has also received his doctoral degree from NIT Trichy. Sir's area of interest includes knowledge and data engineering, data analytics, human-computer interaction, evolutionary computation strategies. Sir has received National Doctoral Fellowships, NDF, from AICTE in the year of 2004 to 2007, and Early Faculty Induction Program Fellowship, EFIP, in the year of 1999 to 2001. Sir is having more than 27 years of teaching experience in various colleges like SSN College of Engineering and Sri Venkateswara College of Engineering. And sir has published more than 40 papers in both national and international journals with a citation score of 246 and H-index of 8 and I-10 index of 6. With this note, I would like to welcome our today's chief guest. Thank you for accepting an invitation for being the resource person for this 5 days FTP program on data analytics in smart healthcare, sir. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you, sir. So I can start, right?
Yes, sir, you can start it now, sir.
I hope my screen is visible.
Yes, sir, it is visible.
Yeah. So good morning and welcome to all, right? So I guess possibly this is the second day of the 5 day workshop on ATL workshop related to data analytics and smart healthcare. Okay, right. So my session, the larger focus will be on an application perspective of data science, typically viewing it as an applied area of artificial intelligence. Okay, right. So that's what I'm captioning the session as: applied AI, a data science application perspective. Okay, so it's more from the application perspective to offer you the to expose you to the breadth of applications from AI perspective that data science as a field offers. Okay. And at least in the initial set of slides, right, we possibly will also be interested in differentiating out. A lot of jargons have come these days, right? Data analytics, data science, big data, right? So ML, AI, right? And people tend to use one in the place of the other frequently. Okay, I'm not saying it is right. At least can we have a better understanding of each of these terms? And then we'll move on to the application flag. Okay. So I think that the word clouds sums up the importance of data, right, and the possible processes that can be applied from data, okay, or over data. Okay. And thank you to the coordinator for that detailed introduction of mine, right? And I wish to start with this quote by W. E. Deming, right, who is a famous statistician, right, and possibly no more has made significant contributions in the domain of statistics. Okay, so he said that it is only in God that we trust, while all others must bring data. Right, so that signifies the importance of data. And I think in this day of, it's no longer in even internet revolution, it is cloud revolution. Right, so the rate at which data gets generated is phenomenal. Right, so I think so how the forefathers or the yesteryear researchers, right, how they had that foresight to say that the data will eventually rule the world, right? So except God, right, we expect all of us to come with data to the table. Okay. So I think the largest spectrum of it, right? Right. So the basic intent, right? So can we quickly differentiate between ML, or is there any difference between machine learning from AI, from data science, from big data analytics, right? And then there's also this terminology of descriptive analytics and predictive analytics, okay, right? So predictive analytics is typically your ML concepts or applied AI over databases, right? So all those terms, the differences will come in as we get into it. Okay. Right. And I think some of the softwares, right, on the big data front, right. That's, I think, these days there are courses which call as big data analytics, where they actually club both issues of storage, huge volumes, how to manage those data, right? So that's on the big data front. And the analytics supported on top of them as well. Okay, right? So some of the tools for them are Hive, Pig, and Scoop, etc. Okay, right? But then my focus is more on the application perspective. Okay, I'll skip through the slide quickly, right? Because I've given the introduction the coordinators have had, right? You can possibly find it from the Institute website as well, right? The reason I keep the slide is somewhere there was a suggestion that at least in an online atmosphere, right? So people should know at least the image of the person they're listening to, okay, right? So this has been my data path. Okay, now getting into the crux or the initial focus that we said we will be interested in, okay, right? So can we differentiate these terms of AI, ML, data science first, and then get on to the applications, okay? Right. The Venn diagram connection I'll make shortly. AI, right, is actually defined as a technique which tries to learn from data, right? As I said, no, this is also machine learning. They often look like the same, but there is some inherent difference in them, okay? So AI attempts at learning from data. What is objective? To make futuristic decisions, okay? Right? And in a sense, what are you actually interested in? Can I train computers to do things which human beings do efficiently, effectively, whichever way you put it, okay, right? Right. So why did they call it artificial intelligence? Trying to mimic the intelligence characteristic or trait in human beings into the system, right? So that is where I'm artificially introducing intelligence into the system, hence referred as AI, okay, right? So I have huge amount of data available, right? Can I have the system, or can I incorporate some intelligence in the system so that it learns from this data, and any learning should help in answering future questions, okay, right? So that's the definition of AI, okay? The machine learning also, this was the same definition which was given to us, right? There's a subtle difference, right? Machine learning also learns from data, agreed, right? But then, right? the limitation of machine learning, right? It is highly restricted to the application domain over which you are trying to do this learning exercise, okay? Just for the sake of example, let's say you are interested in an academic data set, okay? Or maybe your own college data set where you have the marks scored by students in different subjects, right? And you are interested in some analytics, okay, right? So what is the connection between attendance and grades, right? What is the relationship between CGPA and placement, many more such relationships you are interested in, okay? So you have some past data of last 5 year students, data is gathered, okay? Now you do some learning over this, and then you will possibly apply it for new students who join your institute, right? This is what we mean by machine learning. This is a case of machine learning, okay? Right? The machine is learning it fine, agreed. Now the major limitation of ML is, right? And in fact, what is the output of this learning phase is what is typically referred as knowledge. Okay, I think I'll avoid the word pattern because I'll connect it with AI, okay? Right? You can call it information or knowledge, right? So the output of your machine learning phase or machine learning technique is knowledge, okay? Right? So this knowledge is where it will say people who join with this rank or this cutoff and who have this attendance are likely to do well in the BE program, right? So that is one knowledge for me, okay? But then this knowledge that you gain is restricted to your institute, right? So your institute will follow one schema, right? And the machine learning circuit is there. Allow me to come to the chat for a while, right? There are two techniques, maybe it will come later in my slides, right? Supervised learning and unsupervised learning, as they say, okay, right? So if you have past data, right, from which you can do some learning and then handle futuristic questions, that's referred as supervised learning. There is no notion of a past data, there is only one overall data together, okay, right? So then it's referred as unsupervised learning, okay? I hope people are getting my example, right? So this college example I gave, right? So I have learned some pattern, some knowledge from the training data I had, And supervised learning is also for training phase. There are two phases where you call as training phase and testing phase. Okay. Training phase is where you apply some ML model or apply some ML technique to learn. Right, so you learn knowledge, okay. Then in the testing phase, you apply the learned knowledge, okay, right? I'll come back to the slides, right? So testing, sir, what do you mean by testing, right? One example that I normally keep giving, right? I think you people are comfortable with biometric systems or biometric attendance systems, right? So I think either students or faculty, right? We would have used it day in and day out in our institutes or office spaces, right? Initially, when the biometric system was installed, right, the office clerk would have asked you to register your thumbprint or fingerprint 3 times, 5 times, n times, right? That's just number I give, right? That is where you're actually training or teaching the system that this is me, this is also me, right? 5 versions of me, okay, right? And then when you are registered in the system, each day that you go and swipe your attendance, as we put it, right? That is what is called as testing phase, okay? And in this case, the success of the testing is directly proportional to how exhaustive your training is, right? I think you people can interact with the chat here. I hope so. You know, the audience is allowed to be on the chat, text chat at least, okay, right? So this is ML, right? So you supervised learning, let's say we assume, you learn from training data and then you apply the knowledge to test scenarios. That's what I am referring. I hope my most pointer is visible. Test scenarios, okay. Now the problem with this ML is the moment you change your application domain, let's assume you have done it for my institute to create a name Kanjiburam data set, right? The moment I shift it to another institute, say NIT, right, or your own institute, there will be some sort of a schema difference, right? We may follow a credit pattern, you may follow a percentage pattern, we will follow a GPA or a grade notion, some other institute can follow a percentage logic, right? So this is where machine learning, we say, is restrictive, right? I hope people are getting it, right? The knowledge learned, yes, it is applicable as long as it is mimicking my, it may not be the exact training data point, but it has to mimic the training data set, right? The moment it is slightly deviant, it is still education institute data, but it is deviant from my Tripledium Kanjiburam schema, ML may not find its scope well, okay? So that is where AI is a much more powerful technique, right? The output of your ML, right, is typically what is called as, we call this knowledge patterns, is also referred as, okay? AI focuses on the green bullet you look at, right? The larger knowledge behind the patterns learned, right? So it's a much more higher level of abstraction. So AI should be much, even if I learn it from one education institution like Tripledium Kanjiburam, I should be able to apply it to another education institution as well. Not an entirely different setup, but at least similar domains, which is not possible with ML, okay? Right. So that is why in the Venn circle, if you look at, right, AI forms the outer set. The root of all techniques is AI, subset of what is ML, right? A bit restrictive. And these days, right, one of the techniques in ML called as neural networks, right, has been really explored that deep. Right, there are dedicated architectures, several number of layers, right? There's a course nowadays called as deep learning, okay? Deep learning, you can only view it as a subset of machine learning, okay? Are people allowed to ping on the chat? Are things clear thus far? Okay, good. Yeah, you can feel free on the chat. Right, so now I think the base terminologies are differentiated AI and ML, okay. Data science is another target these days, right? That is where it becomes an intersection. The yellow part of the circle you look at first, okay? Right, whether it is AI, ML or anything, right? You will have sufficient amount of concepts from statistics, right? Mathematical formulas and bases, right? And then some visualization tools as well. Visualization meaning graphs, plotting mechanisms, right? Which is what I typically refer as descriptive analytics, right? Using statistics to analyze a data set, right, is typically referred as descriptive analytics, okay, right? EDA stands for exploratory data analytics, Okay, you're actually interested in exploring the current data without going in for any AA or MA. Okay, so data science you can possibly define it as nothing but the study of data, right? Encompassing all, how do I capture data, how do I maintain it? The processing is where your mining and all will come, learning and all, right? Analysis is my descriptive half, and the communicate is presentation, graphs, right? Understandable fashion, you give the output, okay? Right? So if you look at it, data science is actually an intersection of all, yes. So it borrows concepts from all, but then more from an application perspective, okay? Applied perspective, you mean, right? So that is where you can view data science as nothing but an applied AI or applied perspective of AI, okay? And I think these days it is data science, but at least when we all started out in 1988 or somewhere, around 1990, okay? The more famous trend was data mining, okay? So that is where the intersection there was data mining, right? So in a sense, still the same, right? It will borrow concepts from statistics, ML, and AI, okay? Right? So data mining, the way they defined it was, you're actually interested in retrieving, or is retrieval a better word? I think in extraction or mining, you can put it, okay? It's a non-trivial process, meaning to say it's not a simple or straightforward process of extracting hidden, previously unknown and potentially useful information from large data sets. So I think these three are important here, right? The information which you extract from the database is surely not explicitly stored in the data set. It's something which is not known previously, and it should have some potential future value, right? I think people at least who teach courses on databases, right? So they will be interested in this differentiation, right? How does data mining subtly differ from DBMS, right? DBMS, you can only retrieve what is already stored in the data set. Yes, you can give it in a summarized form, average salary, maximum salary, but you can't extract any hidden information or hidden pattern. Okay, I think these words are important from a data mining perspective. Right? Patterns or from now on, use it in an intelligent fashion, but typically A is knowledge and ML is patterns, okay, right? So the pattern discovery is a focus of your data mining process, okay? Whereas your database, you can only, that's why we call it as retrieval, right? Where you retrieve what is already stored, you give it in a user understandable format, fine, right? You can do some amount of summarization, agreed, right? Average, lot of functions are there, right? But surely you can't extract relationships like the one which we said, right? People who score this much rank and then whose attendance is this much are likely to get a placement, right? Plenty of applications are there, right? We'll see them as we go through, okay? Data analytics term has also come, right? I think that's where too many jargons is literally confusing people around, okay? Data analytics typically means the statistical analysis of, they have replaced it as analytics, but typically it is analysis, okay? That technique which focuses on performing a detailed statistical analysis of the data without getting into any ML, AI, nothing of that sort, okay? There are enough techniques in statistics, the power of statistics is really huge, that you can better understand the data, most of your data needs, I'm not saying all, some larger percentage, let's say 50%, 60%, you can answer most of your questions if you do a good amount of data analytics. Be very precise. I call it as data analytics. Typically, we differentiate as being descriptive and predictive. Two more are there, prescriptive and many more differentiations are there, but at least outer level we look at, okay, descriptive and predictive. Predictive analytics is where is equal to ML. Applying ML or ML concepts, AI concepts in data science, data analysis perspective is called as predictive data analytics. Descriptive analytics means using only stats to analyze data. Okay. Simple mechanisms like mean, median, mode, correlation, right, kurtosis, plenty of measures are there, right? And then plenty of plots are also there. Right, so this is what I refer as. I think people have this attraction or craze towards deep learning and machine learning, right? So any data you give, straight away fit the deep learning, whether it's a classification problem or not, right? The ideal, I think you can possibly view it as a flow error. Okay, it is better to do a first step, carry out this process of carrying out performing a descriptive analytics of the data so that you understand which data are important, observe the some key insights from the data. Then possibly take a call if there are any futuristic questions. You can possibly answer it using ML. Okay, so ideally what I suggest and recommend for my course students is, at least as part of the formal courses I meet, okay, right? First place, focus on a good descriptive analytics exercise, then move on to predictive. Okay, let me come back to the slide here. Okay, so that is where data analytics came, and then you can differentiate it as descriptive and predictive. Okay, big data, another term these days, right? Courtesy the cloud, right? The rate at which data is getting generated is no longer in one at one source, right? Huge data volumes are coming up, right? And the rate at which, I think there are five V's which characterize big data, right? Velocity, right? The speed at which it changes, volume is equal to the size, and then the values, right? Different types of values, right? So handle the storage issues of such large data, right? They evolved a separate domain called as big data, okay? Efficient indexing, efficient querying, all this stuff, okay? Right? I think no people should be disturbed with it, right? Can you differentiate between DBMS and big data? Can somebody differentiate on the chat box between DBMS and big data? Nice. Database by itself is big, right? That's why you went in for SQL, data management and all. Then what is the difference between DBMS setup and a big data setup? Hadoop, PySpark, many platforms are there. That's not my focus for sure. The classical DBMS systems which evolved, right? Whether Oracle SQL, MySQL, right? Many things have evolved even off late, right? PostgreSQL, MongoDB, all that stuff, right? Typically, they assume MongoDB is good for big data, fine. Right? The earlier, the S3 revolutions, right? They were focusing on data getting generated at one point, right? And then getting stored as a table, if it's a relational database and all, okay? Right? And then eventually they had some indexing mechanisms to retrieve data. Yeah, correct, that's what I mean, right? So, but these days, data is no longer getting generated at one source, right? We never know from where our Gmail loads, right? Is it from the US server? Is it from the some other country server, right? So I think there's a lot of fault tolerance, duplication, all is there, right? So the rate at which data is getting generated, it is no longer at one source, right? So you can't be living with the classical database storage mechanisms, right? I should have efficient storage mechanisms capable of handling data in the cloud, right? So that is where they started evolving separate area called as a big data. So people are getting the sense of big data, okay, right? Dedicated storage. Now, I generally put it this way, right? How big is big data? It is surely bigger than DBMS. It is surely on the cloud at multiple points, right? DBMS is not capable of handling such humongous volumes of data with changes. Like your stock market is the best example, right? The data changes at a very fast rate, okay? The stock values, I mean, okay? Right? So that is where they said, let us have a dedicated area called big data. And then on top of that, if you add analytics, then it becomes big data plus any analytics that you do becomes big data analytics. Okay. Okay. I think this quote again summarizes the importance of data. Okay. Now, why the hell should we study data science, right? Everybody is doing a course on data science, fine, right? So data people, this is more the roles there. Okay. So people who actually build the models, right? He said ML is used to learn patterns from the data, right? Or AI also learns models from our patterns, right? So the models which will do this learning, right? So people who write the, develop the modules, who build the models to do this learning, they are referred as data scientists, right? I think earlier data mining was used for the same, but these days with Python, a lot of packages are available, right? Doing a predictive analytics task these days in Python is as good as working in Microsoft Excel, right? You just call the package and get it done, right? So that is where now they say You just use packages to learn patterns from data or knowledge from data. You become a data miner. Okay, but then you develop the models, right? Or you develop your packages yourself. You implement the algorithms. Then you become a data scientist. That's what I mean. Development of new artificial methods. Artificial methods, I mean new artificial networks, right? ML models and all. Okay. And people who work on a storage front, right? The architectural issues, right? Scaling up of data, right? They are referred as big data professionals. And the statisticians, right? Are referred as data analysts. How do I acquire, process, and summarize the data, right? So that I can finally eventually sum it up in a understandable report for gaining key insights. Okay. Right. So this line, right, is basically an application difference here, right? Search, I think there is some color code matching. Data mining, right, finds application in, or data science, right, finds application search engines, right? Finance, I've already told, right? Big data, there are plenty of the rate at which your stock values changes, right? Every minute it changes. You can't be living the same old database setup, right? So you need big data techniques, right? Healthcare, right? So that is where you don't have this luxury of huge amount of training data and all, right? You will have very small amount of data. There it makes sense to focus on statistical perspective. Okay, right? And these are non-disjoint, right? You don't have any intersection there, okay? Good. And what are the skill sets ideally related with each of them, right? So people who work on data science or the scientists, right? They typically use Python and ML to develop the models, right? And many more, just a list, right? And on the big data front, right? Java, Scala architecture, MongoDB, as I said, right? So those are the techniques that equip the big data professional. Statistical view, right? The data analytics half, the descriptive analytics half, right? R and Python is good for both. But my understanding is Python is more recommended for predictive, while R is more recommended for descriptive. Now, I'm not saying Python, you can't do descriptive, you can. But I think the reason R came initially, right? It had some relationship with the regression concept of statistics, right? So you are free to choose, right? And I think students have this doubt, right? The most valuable player, right? What is the package? Per month or US dollars, some literature survey material, and this is okay, right? So $123,000 a data scientist approximate, okay, gets big data professionals around 88 and data analysts around 61,000, right? This is not to say that each one role is insignificant or the other way around. It is just a supply chain here, okay? More amount of statisticians are there, right? Than big data professionals, and more amount of architecture or big data professionals are there compared to people trained in ML. Okay, so that's the reason. Okay, so are people clear with the, I'll just momentarily come to the chat. Are people clear with the differentiation so far we had? Good, thank you, man. Yeah, you are free to chat here. I don't know whether you are being used. You are free to think. Otherwise, it will become a monotone once a Ramayana is going on. Okay. Good. Right. So, I think at least from now on, right, you should be in a position to differentiate each of these terms, right? And each one is significant in its own capacity. Okay. Let me reiterate. There is no point in blindly doing ML or predictive analytics straight away, right? And just for that, I don't think I may have it. Okay. Because I'm going on to the applied flair, right? I'll quickly ping it on the chat box. Descriptive statistics, right? There are several plots here. Okay. One such plot, I think you should have heard about it. Many more plots are there, right? The violent plot, the density plot, right? Plenty of plots are there. If you visualize existing data using one of these plots, and each one is okay, if you people will momentarily allow me to, I cannot go through the full slide, but let me see if I have it. And because rather than me saying it, right, if you see, at least you'll get a better idea. Not this frame. I hope it is this slide. So I think there are several plots, right? And then the other basic measures of mean. If you want, I can pass on these slides to you as well. Okay, I don't have any reservations on that. Right, so I think these are some basic statistics for plotting mechanisms which you already know, right? Pie chart, right? Histograms, right? Then there's something called as a dot plot, okay, which is similar to your histogram. But then you possibly can maintain the individual, there is no data loss in dot plots as well, okay. Right? Then there's something called a stem and leaf plots, right? And then your basic line plot or scatter plot as we call, okay, right? So this is what I was looking for, right? Box plot and box whiskers I mentioned, okay, right? So these plotting mechanisms, right? Either based on mean, median or some other statistical measure, we'll give you a quick insight about the data I had, right? Is the data evenly distributed? Is it left skewed towards one half, right skewed towards more towards the maximum, right? But if I get into how do you construct a box plot and all, it will take time, right? The focus of the session will get lost. I can't pass on these slides here, okay, right? So this is what I mean by the power of descriptive analytics, okay, right? So when you do all this, right, so you wouldn't teach anything in that. Right? The essence was just to expose you, okay, right? Go search on these plotting mechanisms. Density plot is actually a combination of, or violin plot is a combination of box and histogram, okay? Several plots are there, innumerable number of plots are there. If you use them ideally, they will help you in gaining crucial data insight. Which data should I focus upon? Right? Then you possibly go and do some mining, right? Rather than blindly looking at mining as a beginning and end of it all. Okay, right? Good, yeah, right? So, I think if the audience is interested, I can pass on those descriptive material as well. Okay, those are my course slides, right? I don't mind sharing it with you as an outside beyond this course session. Okay. Now, the title of this slide, right? Modern apps and analytics. You name any app these days, right? In fact, the name itself has shrunk from application to what we call as an app, right? Some amount of analytics has sunk into it in some way or the other, either descriptive or both descriptive and predictive, okay, right? And the best example I take to understand the power of data science is Gmail. Gmail, sir, it's not an app at all, right? I don't know how many prefer it, right? It started out with Google, right? How many of you are aware of the story how Gmail was actually initially launched? I think it was around 2003 or sometime, exact year I don't recall. But was it where everybody allowed to register for email, Gmail straight away, or how did they do? Google. Was it like Yahoo, right? What was the most famous mail services at that time? Hotmail and Lycos. Yahoo. Did Google start? Google was a famous search engine, right? It is still fine. Hotmail, right? Hotmail Indian connection is, it was by Sabir Bhatia, whose MTech IIT Delhi project work was Hotmail. Okay. Eventually later sold it to Microsoft. How was Gmail rolled out? I know other people are aware of this mechanism, right? Initially, they didn't roll it out as a web subscription service, right? You had to, it was invite-based. Fortunately, I had one of my earlier students who shared me that invite, right? You had to have some employee contact with Google who will share a referral link, and then you'll get their Gmail service, okay? They were very clever, yeah, okay? First 6 months, it was only invite-based. We thought they are making it, no. Now, eventually, they made it an open web subscription, what, web-based service. But this first six months is just an example I give, right? Some expense, okay. They understood the user behavior, right? Key data was gathered. Then the actual rollout happened, right? I think Google's design culture is great. I mean, then you know, quite, I'm interested in HCA or human-computer interaction, right? I think at least one term I'll give them, right? It's a bottom-up company. Where bosses don't dictate everything, it is the other way around, right? Employees are allowed to. Some of the concepts like Google Maps, right? In fact, Gmail itself, right? These all came in their 80-20 rule. What does it say? Right? An employee is allowed to work 20% of his time on his passion. Right? 80% he has to work on the assigned project area, but 20% of the work time, right, he's allowed to. That is where Gmail, Maps, many more such stuff came. Okay. Some products of Google have also failed. Right? Can you name one? Google searches. Okay, searches or their social media equivalent didn't kick off. Okay, right. But their work culture is good and their design thought is also excellent. Okay. Right? Why do you bring in this? Right? So there is, I think nowadays, right, when you say it's an email account, it has virtually become a Gmail account, right? There are still some eccentric who still live with Yahoo, that's fine, right? So what's the reason you feel that Gmail has almost monopolized the email market? Not Google has monopolized the email market. Any guesses? Excellent, right? So I think what you mean is a workspace, right? Lot of through Gmail, correct. You have one Google account, right? Docs, everything is there, spot on, right? But even if you restrict your focus onto the mailing service itself, the amount of predictions, features, they keep adding, right? I think that's phenomenal, right? I think these days there is something called as a nudge. If you have, not budge, nudge, right? If you haven't replied to some email for 2-3 days, right? There is some automated notification comes, right? All of it is nothing but, I think they are quite smart, right? The way they have evolved the service from what it was in 2004 to plenty of AI applications in it. That is where Hotmail and Yahoo lost the race, right? And they still do it, right? And what are we interested in? Can we relate some of the use cases where Gmail is related? Okay, right. I think the first bullet I've explained, right? I don't know how many of you recall in Yahoo, right? Or Yahoo or even Hotmail, right? Somebody sends you an email, you respond to it, each reply, right? And then the other side responds. They all used to be separate emails into my inbox. It was actually Gmail, right? It's brought in this first idea of, if it is happening as a reply to one original message, reply all, reply again and again, right? Then there's a threaded conversation, right? This notion of a conversation itself, Google was the first one to bring in the mailing context, okay? And the designs are great, right? How do they indicate it's a new mail, yeah? There's no much playing with colors and all, right? Highlighted white, with the thick black color text for the mail, right? Or mail text, I mean, okay, right? Simple, but elegant and easy on the eye, right? This will fall into this, I'm not conducting a session on interaction design, agree. That is where Google is good in both analytics and interaction design as well. It's all fine to develop great software and efficient algorithms, but are you giving it finally the way the user wants it, right? So that's where we focus on interaction design, okay, right? let me not get into interaction with him too much. So they were the first ones to bring in this idea of a conversation, right? And then you have this feature, right? In Google, where every incoming mail is viewed as being, I think there's another term for non-spam, right? Whether it's a valid email or is it a spam, right? This, in the data mining circles, in the data science circles, we call it as a supervised learning technique called as data classification, right? So what is objective? Every email that the system gets or the server gets, every incoming email into the server needs to be grouped into one of the two possible classes they have, namely spam or not spam. Right? Spam means moved into a separate folder. Non-spam means moved into the regular folder. Okay. This is nothing but the ML task of what I referred as data classification. Plenty of classifications they do here, right? The moment you log in, right? You have three tabs in your inbox, right? Primary, social, promotions. That is also nothing but classification only, right? And I know how many of you don't notice this feature, priority inbox. Okay, now I'm not getting into, right? I think each of, if it's a course on data mining, right? They will be interested in, okay, just for the interest of the audience, right? What are the predictive analytics techniques? Maybe somewhere it will come. Classification, clustering, association rules, outliers, right? An illustrative list, okay, right? So right now we have seen two applications or use cases of data classification, okay? Data classification is viewed as more as a supervised mechanism, right? I need to have some past data which teaches me for the system, how do I identify spam emails? Any guesses on how the system can do, whether it is a spam or not, on what attributes I mean? Now, we are not interested in the precise algorithms and all, but on what parameters can the system take a call that this is likely to be a spam, this is likely to be a regular email? Somebody has to ping on the chat. Which IP the email is emanating from, right? If it is a restricted countries, and if there are some select words, right? I think our institute, right? The placement used to face is the placement unit, I mean, right? Certain things are important. They put all stars, right? But all stars is actually a blacklisted sequence in mailing literature, okay, right? I hope people are getting it. There are some patterns that are already established, right? Or if you want, you can learn some patterns from it. So that is why you view this as a data classification exercise or a supervisory mechanism, okay? Are people clear thus far, till classification? Why is it called classification? I am interested in grouping the input records I have into predefined number of classes, right? Spam or not is one. Are people comfortable with application exposure thus far? 94 people are there here, at least one or two can ping on the chat. I don't know whether you have been disgraced to ping on the chat, but I believe it's the other way around. Huh. Okay, why you brought in this technique, right? There's also one more feature in Gmail called as priority inbox here. Okay, that is actually an application of AR, association rule mining area in data science or predictive analytics, right? Okay, I think this one I need a ping. Ping, I mean you have to respond, okay. What do you mean by priority inbox feature in Google here, or what do you understand? An inbox that is prioritized. Can somebody move further on that? We are like senior people, don't expect to keep pinging back. Then it becomes a monotony, yes. Be rest assured, I will not move to the next slide if you don't ping back. Priority inbox you have looked at in Google or Gmail feature, right? among the new emails that come into your inbox, right? Excellent. Right? Important, there's another tag. Maybe I think eventually the meaning is the large same. I agree with the DR code, Deepak, so that's called good, right? Among the new emails into your inbox, right? There are some email IDs which you send frequently, right? Which you send emails frequently, or there are some email IDs whose mails you read immediately without delay, right? All these patterns are learned by Google, okay, right? So among the new emails in your inbox, it prioritizes the most important ones, right? That is very correct. Some important emails, good, yeah, both VP and Jay Prabha and Deepak, okay. Right, where is my PDF? Good, right? I think the grouping of those important emails, you can view it as priority inbox, right? And that is actually making use of an area in data mining called as frequent pattern mining. Okay, right? Somehow I'm on the chat frequently, right? Association rule mining is actually two major areas of frequent pattern mining. Association rules generation, okay, right? Okay, the best example I give in my course, right? Amazon and Flipkart and all, you'd go, right? You buy two products, you order, then you have, they have become famous, right? They tend to recommend and force you to buy into or what are referred as recommender systems, right? They are all internally following this base area of what is called as ARM or association rule mining, which again has two subsets, namely frequent pattern mining and association rules, okay? What are the patterns which are frequently occurring in my data set, right? And then based on those patterns, can I connect some rules, right? People who bought a book on C and C++, they also buy a book on object-oriented design, okay? I know how many of you are non-computer science background in this audience, right? People who buy a book on C and fluid analytics are likely to buy a book on thermal engineering something, okay, right? Why am I dragging in books in a discussion of Amazon here? Yeah? Amazon is famous for all other things, useless things, this is fine. But initially when Amazon was rolled out in the initial years, Amazon was only selling what? It was a book portal. Okay, that is where we get this example of people. Kindle version is a hard product to read. Good guess. The initial version of Amazon, I'm not sure which year, the first version possibly you can read. They were actually a book selling portal only, right? They even sell books, but they are selling more things for which they have become more famous than the book version, right? Recommender system. These days you get a lot of recommendations, right? Whether you need, that's the curse of all this, right? You end up buying all things which you don't need, called as marketing or packaging, you make fine, okay, right? So all this will fall into this area of frequent patterns. Your priority inbox is nothing but identifying frequent patterns in my emails here, okay? And somebody answered this. In Gmail, against in each email, you see an yellow-shaped or yellow-colored inverted pentagon, I think. I think it's a pentagon arrow. Right, you see against each email, right, which is indicating what? Against each email there is an yellow color indication. What does that say? You have already answered it. It's an important email, okay, right? How many of you have clicked that? It's actually a clickable, that yellow arrow, right? If you click it, it's actually a toggle switch, okay? If you click it, it becomes uncolored. If you click it once more, it becomes colored, okay? What does it mean? The system is learning it as important, but if you feel the learning is bad, it's not correct, it is wrongly classifying things as important, you are allowed to make the system unlearn. I know. See, that is where they have made an UI as equivalent to a learning mechanism, right? The user still has a control to teach the system, no, you have learned it wrong, learn it this way. Are you getting it? Google's feature of tagging emails as important or not is again nothing but classification. Okay, how does it do? Frequently email IDs could be one, ID such as director, faculty, right? Assignments normally come, right? Typically they are. I think to what extent Google goes, this says it, right? how many times you log in a week, how many times in a day you log in, right? You respond to emails immediately. Every data of yours is being mined, and then the customization is almost individual specific. Okay, right? Okay, so you didn't touch upon this. That was to my surprise, right? Most of the features will connect us. Classification, one again for association with many, okay, right? To my surprise, right, I think it happened long back, right? One of my BTech friends, right? BTech friends, why are you bringing that? Long back, right? This faculty looks old, right? So when was the BTech friend? Almost no connection, right? I am not active on anything on WhatsApp or Facebook, anything, fine, right? So it's almost a 25-year period gap, right? I get a mail from him, right? I was really surprised to see Google classify or Google treat it as important. Okay, why? The earlier theory we gave, right? If you have got emails from some ID frequently, some IP director like this, important, it is fine. This is an email ID which the system has not seen at all. It ideally to be moved into spam, right? But still it is classifying it as important. What is your guess? How can it do? Let's show us the slide. Okay, question is clear now. The body of the message is also being mined. Okay, right? I think your BTech friend, normally you have this colloquial way of writing. Pattern is linked to Gmail. I think that's what you're meaning, right? But this is not a case of classification. In that case, at least I personally view it as a case of clustering, right? It is actually looking at the body of the text, the subject, right? Because friends normally have a colloquial, I don't want to get into what was the colloquial stuff in that gene, may leave that, right? You don't have a formal way of writing, sir, ma'am, and all, right? You have a mix of all Tamil words, Hindi words, right? If you are a Hindi speaking audience, right? So to what extent that mail is informal, it is likely, I hope people are getting the importance of it, right? Professional emails getting classified as important is one thing. No, don't call it unprofessional, right? That to that extent they are mining the data, and in this case I view it as clustering, right? Clustering in what ML stands for, unsupervised technique, right? Where you are interested in grouping records without any training data, right? I have a collection of records, can I group similar records together? Okay, right? And I think the best example we can give these is, right, the COVID infected zones, right? The red zone, right? The coloring you leave, right? Red is of high intensity, right? That is nothing but grouping zones based on some similarity of infection level or transmissibility level of the virus, right? So clustering is another ML technique, okay, right? So that is also being used by Gmail. Okay, I think I'm done with Gmail, most of it. Okay, I think these applications I'll scroll through quickly. Okay, right? Many more applications are there, right? The banking sector uses it, uses classification to predict the loan risk, right? Classify a customer who's applying for a loan, right? Whether he's a low-risk customer or high-risk customer. Low-risk are the ones who have a decent amount of salary, their CIBIL scores are more, right? Not on database level characterization, hidden patterns, like his repayment history, many more, okay, right? And fraudulent card analysis is another area in banking, which is nothing but outlier mining, okay? Outlier is a complementing approach to clustering. Whatever falls outside the clusters, right? They are typically viewed as outliers, right? Okay, just one question I'll ask. Fraudulent card analysis, right? These days, what happens here? When you're actually transacting, They have actually made it even smaller amounts these days, earlier days at least, right? A debit card is lost. Which card is better to lose here? Is it a debit card or a credit card? It's better not to lose any card, fine. Among the two, which is better to lose? How does this question relate to data analytics? It's a real life question here. Yeah. Which card is safe to lose? I am surely not a Paytm person and all, right? I still live with the old Paytm cards. Which card is better to lose? A safe one to lose, sir. quick. Yeah, I think these are general questions. You can take a wild guess, right? Fraudulent card analysis is that area. I think people can keep answering there as they move further. Fraudulent card analysis, right? Is a card that is being used by somebody, is it a valid use or is it a fraudulent use? Okay, right. What do you mean by debit card losing? Right, debit card, if you lose, if at all somebody can steal, they can steal only the amount you already have, right? And there's also some upper ceiling in it. Credit is about money which you don't have, but eventually you will have to repay, right? So in that sense, at least, sir, credit is not my money. Finally, with interest, it goes. Okay, right. Many people are watching for credit cards. It's okay. The debit card, right? Normally, people exhibit a pattern here, right? In fact, I was surprised to see even these days, right? The same ATM 2-3 times you use, right? They eventually a new button comes these days. Your favorites withdraw 8,000, right? My pattern of withdrawal is 8,000, right? It has learned it, and it is stopping me even from entering withdraw or clicking that button and then entering 8,000 everything. Straight away, a button option called 8,000. Okay, right. So there is an established pattern of user interaction, right? Let's say every 10 days once I withdraw 8,000. Okay. Now suddenly my card goes in somebody's hands. He is not going to be that decent enough to behave like me. He'll possibly try the upper limit of 40,000. Okay. 40,000. Yes. Okay. Right. So that is where the system uses as a deviant transaction or outlier. So that is where they check sending an SL. These days they have carried it really too forward. Even checks these days, you see, right? You issue a check, what happens? There is an SMS to you which says a check has been issued, right? Did you actually issue it or not? Basically to prune out deviant transactions. Okay. So this area in data mining we call outlier analysis. And Amazon, right? They have a patent called as anticipatory package shipping. Right, I mean, it gets delivered at the rate of knots, right? Even in the day of Varda or these days cyclone, right? It still comes out. The story goes that the product is not packaged on your name after you order and all. It is actually on the truck. Collection of products are on the truck based on your past purchase pattern. The only thing they are waiting for is the moment your order comes, the label is pasted on the truck on delivery, right? So geographically similar areas grouped together, right? Lot of relationship patterns they do, right? That's what they call as an anticipatory package shipping. They don't wait for this package order to come. They anticipate and ship it and then paste the label or en route. And I'm surely not a good person to talk on Netflix, right? The movies that you get on Netflix, right? Most watched movies, right? I think YouTube, right? Recommended videos, right? You search one, you get a... Academics, I think we are happy with it, right? We go and search for Dijkstra's shortest path algorithm, we get a lot of good recommendations in that. That's the problem of all these HRFs here, right? What are HRFs? You seem to be an old-fashioned guy. What are HRFs? Hyperlinks here, right? Pointers or hyperlinks. Eventually, your recommendations are nothing but hyperlinks only, right? That is where the web has also become a distraction for the younger generation these days. Fine. Good. Okay. Connect everybody in this world is actually one hoop up with Cambridge Analytica. Okay. Right. Cambridge Analytica was actually one firm which was outsourced by Facebook to do some survey. Okay. And in the name of connecting a digital world or something, right? They scooped in a lot of private data of end users on Facebook, and which was eventually used to influence the US elections. That is what the US Senate hearing finally concluded. Okay, right. So that is where, right, data mining is good, but there are dangers of how you use the data as well. And what better example than Facebook for data analytics, right? What all connections it brings in, right? School friend, and then that school friend's friend with whom we have met a lot. Some interconnection if it finds out, right? And then these days, right, you go and try recharging your phone. First thing is important is the offers are customized to each number, okay? Somebody who doesn't use an SMS at all, right? They don't give they give more call time than SMS, number of free SMSs. Right. So all that you are nothing but targeted advertising, as they call in the cell phone industry as well. All those are cases of data science at work. Application, I mean. Okay. And Uber, right? This is what I meant. Digital life. This was that Facebook's the Cambridge Analytica failed episode. Okay, I think because the focus of the workshop, okay, had I had time, I would have related more from PV. Let's see if I have, okay, I think some projects I can talk about, fine. Uber is also one case, right, where let's say you book a taxi, onwards then you are sure you want to go by car. You go with the decision that I'll come back by bus, eventually before you leave, what happens? Before, I think half an hour before actually, half an hour is just a random number again. What does Uber do? Uber or Ola, whatever it is. As long as the GPS is on or the tracker is on, what happens? They do send some offers, right? If you take up this return journey this way, the nearest cab is available in the next 5 minutes at a reduced rate of even this much, right? So what extent can we whether attract or force is a better word, right? So that is the amount of targeted advertising that is data science is helping it. Okay, right? This area, healthcare, right? That's where you're interested in. Okay, right? I think even in the COVID era, right? People were interested in predicting the number of mild, serious, I don't know whether it's the correct classification from the COVID point of view, right? Mild, serious, and very serious, let's say, okay. Right, they were interested in predicting it well in advance so that they can equip the hospital infrastructure according to that. Right, they are right. How many ICUs equipped with what are they called? Oxygen concentrators, right? Do I need? Right, so there is good amount of predictive analytics which is helping the healthcare as well. Okay, and the same predictive analytics when applied in the pharma agency, pharma sector, pharma is pharmaceutical industry, that is what they call as pharmacovigilance, okay, right? What do you mean? I think you should have heard this word called clinical trials, right? What does that clinical trials word mean here? What does clinical trials in a drug data setup mean? Drug or pharma? Clinical trials here, COVID vaccine, you can relate, right? So we have taken a solemn oath not to ping back. You can break that oath there. Research on new tests has received. Very good. Right. So before a medicine is rolled out to the market, right, I need first place to test it on more poor animals, right? Not majors who mimic the human anatomy or characteristic. Then do some amount of basic tests on human beings as well, right? The problem with this clinical trials is eventually some are being treated as guinea pigs, right? Even that is a life, right? So what the current drug industry is actually, I think there are good amount of works also on that. Okay, what they're actually doing it is you have some past history of, and I am famous or I am aware of all these tablets, so I'm putting it on, right? The Staplo, which is a BP drug, Glycomax, which is a sugar drug, right? Each drug it causes, this past data is there. Okay, right now somebody who's interested in or somebody who's coming up with a new molecular combination of a new drug to treat diabetes, let's say, right? Look at the interaction pattern among the molecules based on the past data and their the side effects. I think in the drug industry they call it as adverse ADR prediction, adverse drug reaction. Okay. The industry has gone that far these days that they don't want it to happen physically. Eventually, they will do it for medical confirmation. That's different, right? But then, can we have an automated system which is likely to predict this severity of the side effects even before when it's actually gone live, right? I think the FDA is the drug agency of the US. Similarly, we have one in the Indian setup, okay, right? They are strongly watching for use of ML techniques in the area of pharma sector, which is called as pharmacovigilance. Okay, right. ADR I've used here, adverse drug reactions or drug safety surveillance, they say. Okay, And my notion, the best mining product is a human brain. Okay. The way we respond to new scenarios, the system can be intelligent. This is the joke in the BTEC evaluations we share, right? All our deep learning projects, and they claim 100% accuracy, right? Then it is not ML, right? You never can have 100, but that's where human beings beat the code, right? The way we respond to even slightly different new scenarios is much intelligent than the system, right? So the gap is how do you, classical person, right? Will robots entirely replace human beings? Not, right? How you use it effectively for, I think that use of AI for drug industry, right? It's a real good boon, right? Not to waste people or not to risk with people's lives unnecessarily, right? Minimize the side effects first. When you're convinced, then go and test it clinically as part of some clinical trials. Okay, right? So I think I've done it, right? I think this is more for the data mining course, right? Where we call it as what are the phases in data mining. Then the first 1, 2, 3, 4, we call it as pre-processing. Okay, I don't want to get into the specifics, right? How do I convert the data into form that is suitable for mining? That is what we call data pre-processing, right? And then the later halves, right? How do I give the pattern mined in an interesting fashion? Okay, right? If you look at it, the leading half, 1, 2, 3, 4, this will be heavily playing with statistics. This is where ML comes, the core. And then this is where knowledge presentation or mechanisms come. Okay. This I talked about, right? Sir, we have finished ML, sorry, not. This is just major areas in predictive analytics here, right? And under each, there are plenty of algorithms, right? If you want to give me a minimum number, 20 each, you can put. A priori, FP growth for association rules, decision trees, for random forest for classification, k-means, hierarchical for clustering, right, regression, right? Many more are there, okay, right? But at least what each are, we are focused and the application of it. Okay, I'm almost through the end of it. So we are waiting for the bill. Good. I believe in paying back the loyalty and royalty back. Right? So these are some good resource persons whom you can trust upon, right? Okay, just one question. Jeffrey Ullman in computer science, which subject do you follow here? Yeah? There should be some computer science faculty in this audience, right? Jeffrey Ullman's book, you followed for which course? Compiler design, right? But he's an equally famous person from Stanford for data mining contributions. Rajiv Motwani, okay, right? He's again a Stanford prof, unfortunately no more, right? He was actually BTEC alumnus from Kharagpur, if I recall it. Kharagpur or Kanpur, 1K. Okay. There is I think just go and read about the memoir written by the Google founders here. Okay, right. He was actually the guide of Google's founders, Sergey Brin and Larry Page. Okay. He was their MS guide. Eventually, they didn't finish their MS. That's a different story. But he was the initial mentor for the startup Google. Okay. Right. And the way I think he died in a freak swimming pool accident in the US, okay, at a very young age of 48. His contributions are phenomenal. Okay, right. Again, a core statistician and a mathematician, and then a data scientist. Okay, whenever you use a piece of technology, there's a good chance there's a little bit of Rajiv Motwani behind it always. That sums up, right? Jivai Han from University of Illinois, Urbana-Champaign. Okay, he is also famous for the FP growth algorithm. His data mining book is a good resource, right? And Dr. Sanghutheva Rajsekaran, right? So I know him personally, at least he is a chair at the University of Connecticut. He is also another famous person. He is a co-author for that Horowitz and Sahni data success book, but he has also made phenomenal contributions in data mining as well. Okay. Some industry guys, Larry Page and Sergey Brin, Professor Kirti Ramamudam, IIT Bombay retired professor emeritus now. He is another landmark person in India for data mining and databases. Right. Rakesh Agarwal, name sounds Indian, but he is a BISMAT professor. Okay. He was the man who invented the first algorithm for a priori, for association rule mining, associated with IBM Labs. Right. Raghu Ramakrishnan, who is again with BISMAT, right? famous for his data. I think he's also made a good amount of data mining contributions. If I recall well, I think his BTEC was from IIT Madras. Okay. These are all excellent resources on data mining and data science. Right? I'm not good on that. Fine. And this fellow, Osmar Zain, is actually a PhD student of Ajwa I had. Mm-hmm. So I think he works at the University of Alberta, Canada. Right? Both. Mm-hmm. Simon Fraser University is also a famous university in Canada for data mining research. Okay. So this is just an illustrative list. Right? So you are free to Google more. Mm-hmm. And some projects which our team works on, right? Maybe basic, still their core is still data mining. We have used data mining to come up with intelligent compression algorithms for text, image, and video data. Right? In fact, one PhD thesis was based on that. Right? How did we use that becomes a PhD thesis difference. But the essence is we use frequent pattern mining to do text compression, image compression, and video compression. Okay. And then we have used frequent pattern mining over adverse drug reactions in PD. Right? And then some level of data mining on images of photographs, right? Basically to find out whether somebody is having suicidal tendency or not, right? But these are all quite preliminary work in progress, okay? And then we also use data mining for summarizing NPTEL videos. Mm-hmm. It should be a connected stitch. Okay, I'll not give these are my research results, right? And this I'll not spend, this is actually work on captures here, okay, right? Which is more on the interaction design front. Right? So I'll not get into that. And these are some of the companies with it, whom we are associated with. Okay, we were in the past, right? Intrain is actually a company that builds solutions for GRE. ETS they call, right? So they wanted to create, that there is something called as AW, right? Some analytical writing skill, right? Right now, the evaluation is happening manually. They wanted us, a student team worked on it, to grade the essays on a score of 1 to 6 using ML techniques automatically. Okay. And then some amount of adverse drug reaction with a drug industry called Data Foundry. Okay. I'm almost done. Right. So I'll stop sharing my slides. If you have any questions, you can pick. Yeah, I think I'm almost on time. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
What is the mechanism? They are allowed to ask on the chat, or they are allowed to unmute and ask?
Sir, I'll ask it. So, dear all, sir has completed his beautiful lecture in a precise way. So, I would like to. It's a time for the participants to ask questions if you have any. Your queries are welcome, and if you have any queries, you can also post it in the chat box so that sir can reply to your queries. Thank you.
Your attendance will not be granted if you don't ask questions here. Well, I think this is a senior audience, right? Just on the lighter side, I said.
Dear professors, if you have any queries, you can ask in the chat box. If not, you can have a permission to unmute yourself.
Anyway, it is fine. It is clear.
Sir, actually, one question has came in the chat box. Sir,
he said it is clear. Yeah, I am quite active on the chat. I use the chat as almost as a whiteboard, blackboard here. Okay. Okay, good. Right. I think my email. I am not on WhatsApp and all. Right. I still live with an old age phone. This is my email ID, right? Any collaborative interest, right? Somebody who's from the industry or other colleges, right? You can ping, that's my email ID, okay, right? So that's my institute email ID, right? No other email IDs and all, okay, right? Phone number, it's not a secret, but I'm bad on the phone. Huh.
Dear participants, if you want to ask any queries personally to us, sir, so you can use the mail ID, that is SIBALSCLVAMB.
If you want, just I'll show my phone also. I don't have WhatsApp. Hello.
Participants, if you have any queries, you just please post your queries in the chat box. If not, please unmute yourself and ask your own so that sir can reply to your queries.
Yeah, I wish you all the best. Thank you. Stay safe. So, sir, can I disconnect? There are calls in the office.
Hello. 1 second, sir. Dear participants, you could find the feedback link on in the chat box that is posted by Praveen Kumar APEC. So I request you all of you to fill the feedback form without fail, since that is going to act as your attendance. So I request all of you to please fill in the feedback form without fail. And if you do have any queries, you can post it in the chat box. If not, please unmute yourself and you have a provision for that, so that you can ask doubts with the professor who is with us. For the program, the feedback is important and it is going to act as an attendance for you people. So I request all of you to please post your attendance and as well as please post your feedbacks and give your feedbacks without fail. Thank you. Sir, I request you to please be online for another 5 to 7 minutes, sir, so that if anyone asks any questions, you can answer.
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. Sir, a query has raised in the chat box saying how to apply for PhD in IIIT DM.
I have answered, sir.
Okay, sir. Sir, I think that's all from the participant side, since they are with.
Explain what love to God is greater than the first such. Actually, R is applicable to humans. Yeah. Yeah, we can wind up, sir.
Okay, sir. So, and I would like to conclude this session with a formal vote of thanks, sir. So, on the behalf of the management, Knowledge Institute of Technology, and in Dr. P.S. Srinivasan, sir, founder and principal of Knowledge Institute of Technology, I would like to thank you for accepting our invitation for being the resource person for this faculty development program, and was a fruitful session as well as what we discussed in the morning, that we are going to have some fruitful session today. So thank you so much for happening to us as a resource person, and you have shared your experience and then your insights about data science, and which helps us and as well as the participants to get more things into this data science. So I would like to, I'm expecting you for the upcoming FTPs and STTPs, if any we are going to conduct. So thank you so much for being the resource person for us. Thank you.
Thank you for the opportunity, sir.
Thank you, sir. Welcome, most welcome. And dear participants, as I already mentioned in the chat box, we have posted the feedback link. So I request all of you to please post the feedback without fail, since that is going to act as your attendance. So please do it without fail. Thank you. And the next session will start from 11:45. Thank you. I would like to tell you, sir. And one more question is there in the chat box. Meenal, ma'am. Meenal, ma'am, if you want to interact with sir, you can use the mail ID which he has posted in the chat box, so that you can send your query and you may expect your reply from. Thank you, ma'am.